Now, let us understand what is unemployment, what is the unemployment status in India, and what the government is doing about unemployment. See, whenever I speak about this word unemployment, remember we are considering the population between the age group of 15 to 60. Okay, so this is the age group. If these people, that is the people who are in the age group of 15 to 60, are not able to find work for their living, for their livelihood, then they are said to be unemployed. Okay, now there are various kinds of unemployment. How do the first question arises here? How does the government gets the data about unemployment? See, it is either through the census, that is people you would have seen coming to your home, okay, taking data about your family, asking you if they are, people are working anywhere and where they are working. Okay, so they collect all that data. So that is the census. Then you have the NSSO's report, and then you have Directorate General Employment and Training report, which comes out. Okay, from these sources the government is able to get data about unemployment. Okay, now there are types of unemployment, the first being open unemployment. This is nothing but you would have seen your friends, your cousins, or maybe you would have seen many other similar people searching a job. So reading a newspaper where the jobs appear, the job vacancies appear, right? Or you would have seen someone approaching to your mom or dad for a job, or asking them to submit their resume or their CV into the offices they work, right? So these are the people who are willing to work, want to work, but they do not have a job. That is, there is no one who is giving them employment. This is open unemployment. Now, even when it comes to casual workers, so you would have seen people standing on the road wherein they are offering their services in terms of plumbing or maybe the regular work which we require on the construction site. So if they do not get hired for a day, then in that scenario they do not have work. Okay, so even that would be considered as unemployment. Okay, now there is some seasonal unemployment. What is that? See, what happens here is agriculture sector is dependent on monsoon. So once the monsoon is gone, what we do, we sow the seeds and then we have to wait for the harvest. Post that, there is a lag time, which is the time when the farmers become unemployed. Okay, so seasonal job is there would be no job in a particular season. Now I gave you one example of the farmer. The second one being would be your ice cream factory. Many a times the factory would be hiring tremendous or would increase the number of people working with them because the season is, the summer season has come, and then this number of people would be removed or they would be on a contract basis. So once that summer season is gone and once the winter set in, they again would become jobless. So these are few examples of seasonal unemployment. Now you would have also seen that many a times there are many vegetable vendors, fruit vendors, or similar kind of workers we meet who are there for some time in the city. They come to urban areas, they sell all these things, and then for some time they are not there. The reason they are not there is they go back to the villages as it is rainy season, and then they start growing the crops out there. So they work partly in the rural area, go there, do the agriculture, do the farming out there, and then come back to the city and try to earn money by being a casual worker or by being a vendor. Now this is another kind of unemployment which is known as disguised unemployment. Now how do I identify disguised unemployment? Let's say if you require 10 people on your piece of land to do the do a certain process of farming. Okay, now if you remove 5 out of those 10, still you're getting the same results, that is it is the same productivity which you're getting, that means there was disguised unemployment. Okay, so there were extra 5 people who were working who were not required to work on that piece of land. Similarly in industry, if I require 10 people to produce one toy, okay, and if I remove that particular person, let's say I remove 3 people from there, and still the 7 people are able to give me same number of toys in a day, that means 3 people were extra and it was disguised unemployment. Okay, now what about the efforts which the government is taking. We already discussed the measures in the earlier chapters. Let's discuss the few other things. See, the first initiative is direct employment. As I told you in the earlier slides, what the government is doing, it has been hiring. It is a largest source of employment provider. Why? Because it has a huge administrative setup and you require people for that, right? It has been controlling the public sector unit, so it require people for managing those companies. Then they have defense, they have even the police force. So all this creates direct employment. Now tomorrow, if they want to improve the direct employment, they can even go ahead and set up a factory. So once they set up a factory, again the people will be required to manage it, right? So this is the way direct employment is provided. What about indirect employment? Now let's take this example. If a car manufacturing unit is being set up, so it requires parts from various other units, okay? Like it requires the gearbox, it requires the steering wheel, it requires the wheels. All these are prepared by auto ancillary units. So if the production of the car manufacturing unit increases, what will happen? The ancillary unit will also have to increase their production. So this is a kind of indirect employment, because when the car manufacturing unit will start increasing the number of units they are producing, the number of units of the cars they are producing, so they will employ more people. But then simultaneously, all the units which are associated with this car manufacturing unit, that is these auto ancillary units, even they will have to employ more number of people. Now what the government does, let's take an example of the steel industry. So if they have a steel industry in control, they would start increasing the output of the steel industry. Now because they would increase the output of the steel industry, the providers, that is the people or the businesses which provide the government or the steel industry the inputs, they will have to increase their output also, right? So let's say we have this XYZ steel company, which is state owned, that is government owned XYZ steel company. Now if they increase the amount of steel production, then from the number of raw material, the quantity of raw material will also have to be increased. So the industries which are related to providing raw materials to this XYZ company, this will also automatically increase. That's known as indirect employment. Now we discussed on the government programs in earlier chapters. So we have this Rozgar Yojana, we have the Sampoorn Gramin Rozgar Yojana. So these were various initiatives taken by the government to ensure employment for rural workers, casual workers. Okay, now as of today, what is the situation? See, this is the estimated figure given to us by the United Nations. This is the figure for 2017-2018. It says 3.2% of the population would be unemployed in this particular year. That is approximately 17.8 million people. So that's a huge amount of people who are unemployed in the country currently.